We sing your faithfulness, come on.
We see your faithfulness in the darkest night. We see your goodness, God. Favor on our lives. Everywhere we go, your grace is on our side.
Welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. I'm so glad that you joined us today. My name is Tommy Kreitz, and I serve as the co-campus pastor of our Elgin campus, and I also oversee Harvest students on all of our campuses. Listen, we would love to know where you're watching from today, so let us know in the chat or in the comments. And listen, if this is your first time with us, I want to give you a special welcome right to you. No matter where you're joining, we're so glad that you're here today. And listen, whether you're new or you come every single week, we want to invite you to check in. And you can do that on this page through the link in the comments, or you can do that on our Harvest Bible Chapel app. We would love to know that you're here today, and we would love to pray for you this week as well. So thank you so much for doing that. Well, Pastor Eddie Hoagland concludes this series, Yes, I Will, today. And next week, we're going to be starting a new series through the Old Testament book of Ruth called Finding Hope in a Disappointing World with Dr. Michael Rydelnik. Dr. Michael Rydelnik is a longtime friend of Harvest and is a professor of Jewish studies and Bible at Moody Bible Institute. And he's a host and Bible teacher on Open Line with Dr. Michael Rydelnik, answering listeners' Bible questions every Saturday morning for more than 200 stations across America. Dr. Rydelnik is also the co-editor of the Moody Bible Commentary, along with our own Dr. Mike Van Landingham. And he's the author of Understanding the Arab-Israeli Conflict and The Messianic Hope. Is the Hebrew Bible really messianic? Wow, I cannot wait for him to open the book of Ruth to us starting next Sunday online and in person. Well, today in our service, we will be remembering the Lord as we take communion. So find some juice and a cracker or a small piece of bread and be ready to observe this ordinance of the church together. Well, last Saturday, this is really exciting, we opened Hope Centers on three of our campuses. I want you to check this out right now.
Hey, Harvest, Ramirez here, standing in front of our brand new Hope Center here at our Rolling Meadows campus. And we're so excited today. We have an opportunity to bring hope to our communities.
Yes, the Lord has just been so faithful, from volunteers through generosity, through the registries, people dropping off stuff every single day, multiple times a day. Today, 30 volunteers came to our campus to shine the light of Christ. And it's just been a beautiful thing just to see people praying, sharing scripture. Guys, that is the main mission of this Hope Center, is to show them the love and hope of Christ. So thank you guys so much. We're just so excited about what the Lord's gonna continue to do through this ministry this year.
So good. The Hope Center, a place where people can come through our doors and get a tangible expression of help. And we get to have an opportunity to share with them the hope of Jesus.
Well, we thank the Lord for the great work he is doing in and through his church. Well, listen, women, this is for you. Mark your calendars for Friday night, March 5th, and Saturday, March 6th for the Harvest Women's Conference. The theme for this year is God over all. And the conference will take place in person at the Rolling Meadows and Elgin campuses, as well as online, which means that no matter where you live, you can engage in this event. If you want more details on that, you can check out harvestnow.info. You know, God continues to show his kindness to us as a church through your faithful giving. You can give online on this page or through a link in the comments. On the Harvest Bible Chapel app, you can do it through text. You can do it by mailing your gifts to the Rolling Meadows campus. And now we have another way. You can hold your camera up on your phone to the screen, up to this QR code on the screen, and it will take you directly to the giving page on the Harvest website. The way you give online through a text with the QR code is not important. What God sees is your heart. Matthew 6:21 says, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." And our prayer is that your heart and your treasure are where you see God working. As we continue in worship, would you join me in prayer? Oh Lord, we're so thankful for the work that you're doing in and through us and our church. Lord, I pray as we open the Word of God right now that you would speak to us. We know that you have truth for us today. And so, Lord, would we lean in with our minds and our hearts, and would we listen attentively to your word, and would we not only hear it, but, Lord, would we do what your word says to do? Would we be doers of the word? Would your word transform our lives? Would we become more like your son? Lord, we love you. We thank you for this time where we can worship you and hear from you. And we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Hey, why don't we stand again, and we're going to worship the Lord this morning. It's good to be in the house of God. Amen. Yes. Yes. Feels good to gather together. And hey, I have some new friends on stage. We had our vertical worship cohort 2021 for the first time on Thursday and Friday. And so we had about 50 people in, and it was awesome. And we're just training and encouraging and building up. And we're running alongside these people for the whole of 2021. And when they're in town with us, they're going to be on our stages. And so they are scattered across our campuses this weekend. Over to my far left, that's Victoria. And then Thomas and Becca, she's been back a few times as well. It's great. So she's part of the family now as well. And then Tia on the far right. Why don't you just welcome them? And we're in the house of the Lord, so we're going to sing about the Lord. And we're going to sing about his goodness and his faithfulness. But we're going to sing the gospel story out this morning. And that should put thanks in our hearts, folks. Jesus is alive in this place. He is alive within us. We have so much to be thankful for. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Sing with me. The moon and stars, they wept. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, and his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon us. Thank you, Lord. church, you know this. So the crowd began to shake, and the stone was rolled away. His perfect love could not be overcome. The good news, now death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated.
The Lamb is the... Come on, just minister to the Lord this morning. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is on. We're saying thank you. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. Because the Lamb is overcome.
Overcome.
We sing hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome.
And in that breath, just take the communion element that you had given to you when you walked in this morning and just prepare that in your hands. Just get it ready. Because we're going to say thanks this morning. You know, I've been really mindful in the last couple of weeks. I've been thinking about this a lot. Just as a parent, I have four boys at home, and when we approach the table and we eat, I've been teaching my kids to say what? Thank you. Hey, make sure you say thank you before you're done. And I just kind of confess that I feel like as adults, I can only speak for myself here, but I've lost the art of saying thank you at the table. Thank you, Lord. It's not just saying a prayer over the food at the beginning, but it's also eating of the bread and drinking of the cup and saying, God, thank you, thank you. And we approach the table in reverence, but brothers, sisters, this is a place of joy for us. This is not a place of, there is a place for repentance here, but Christ Jesus did not die for you so that you would be in a place of repentance. He died for you so that you would go through that and come to a place of being and experiencing the complete fullness of God in Jesus Christ, which is to stand up and which is to say, I'm alive because of Jesus. And we come to the table that way this morning. As the people for thousands of years would approach the Holy of Holies, they would come out of the valley, they would ascend the hill of the Lord, and they would come into the temple grounds, but they would never be allowed into the Holy of Holies because that was just allowed for the priest. But then Christ came for us, and he brought his disciples, his families, his sinners and his friends to the table, and he said, this is my body, which is for you, this is my blood. And then he went to the cross, and he died for us. Listen to this from the book of Hebrews. Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Brothers, sisters, we have access now through Jesus Christ. And we are thankful. And we should say thank you at the table. Lauren's going to sing these verses over us. Just hold these elements in your hand for a second. Just listen to these words. And then we'll receive the elements together, okay?
See him there, the great I am, a crown of thorns upon his head, the Father's heart displayed for us. Oh God, we thank you for the cross. We do, God. Lifted up on Calvary's hill. In 1 Corinthians 11, it says that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's take the bread together. In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." So we take the cup and we remember today, Jesus. Let's take it together. Church, we remember the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ today. But we don't remember in sorrow or sadness, but we remember with joy and gratitude in our hearts. Come on, give him thanks and praise. Give him thanks and praise. Behold the Lamb, the story of redemption written on his very hands. Jesus, you.
All right, all right. Well, today we conclude our three-week series called Yes, I Will, and I gotta say, I'm like a little sad for some reason. It's kind of like when you watch a trilogy of movies, right? And then you watch the last movie, and how do you feel? You're kind of like, it's over. Like, that was it. All that's left is to digest the unacceptable amount of popcorn I just ate. That's what I feel at the end of a trilogy. Or if you read a trilogy of books, and you read that last book, the last chapter, you close the book, and you feel just a little sadder. So I've been told that when you read three books in a row, you can feel sad at the end. It's not just movies. I'm a bit more of a movie guy myself, but you know, we started this series talking about this song, Yes, I Will, and how these lyrics and this melody have been guiding us this week. And we've talked about some of the themes in this song, like I will lift you high in the lowest valley. And we've talked about what is our responsibility in the valley. And we've also talked about I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy, when I feel the weight of fear. What am I supposed to do when I feel that weight on my heart? We've talked about that. And then this week, we're going to be camping on what really is the core theme of the song, which is the word volition. It's your choice. It's about responding, not just seeing God for who he is, not just seeing what he's done, but then once you see that, then choosing to respond to him. And this song kind of has a bit of a slingshot effect, if you've ever noticed it. So it kind of starts, and then you just know something's coming. We sing the verse, the chorus, and sure enough, after we get to the second chorus, the band builds, and we get to this release, which is the bridge of the song, with the words, and I choose to praise. I choose to praise. So I will walk through the valley, I will fear no evil, and today, I will choose to praise. Let's pray together as we get started. Father, before I say another word, I want to bless your name. And I want to thank you for the ways that you've been teaching us, the ways that you have been ministering to us. Thank you, Lord, for the times I've had with you through this series and for all the ways that you've blessed us. God, you're such a good God to us. And we're asking that today would be no different, that we would hear from you, that we would sense your presence. We invite you here. In the name of Jesus, amen. Amen. All right, Psalm 23 is where we've been the past couple of weeks, and we've already studied from verses 1 through 4, and then today we're going to finish our series by just studying verses 5 and 6. Now, the picture that we've been studying is going to shift. We've been talking a lot about a shepherd and sheep and all the illustrations that that brings, but today that picture's changing, and I'm pretty confident it's a different picture because a sheep is not going to sit at a table and have a meal with a shepherd, so clearly there's something else going on in verse 5. And so we're shifting from a shepherd and sheep to a king or a host and his guests. That's what's happening in verse 5 and 6. Now, my message today for you is really, really straightforward. I can say it in one sentence. This is what I'm going after today. You have a reason to praise. That's what I want to tell you. You have a reason to praise. And some of you, you've already started arguing with me and you're like, no. You got to know this. You got to know that. I got a couple reasons not to praise. I get that. Look, but here's my message for you. You have a reason to praise. No matter what you're going through today, no matter what weight you're feeling on your heart, you have a reason to praise. I want every single one of you to hear that from me. You have a reason to praise. How could I make that point? We need to maybe insert your name there. Let's see here, front row on this side of the room. Give me your first name. Well, I already know you, but this kind of should be people I don't know, right? But all right, Kim. Kim is up here in the front row. Kim, you have a reason to praise. Absolutely. That's right, amen. What about right here? What's your first name? Dan? Dan, you have a reason to praise, and I'm not going to do this for the whole room. So everybody, insert your first name. Here we go, at the count of three. One, two, three. Has a reason to praise. That's who has a reason to praise. You have a reason to praise. And I'm about to spend 30 minutes or so bringing this case to you that you have a reason to praise God today. No matter what you're walking through, you have a reason to lift high his name and to praise the name of God. Because 1 Thessalonians 5:18 says this. It says, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. If you've ever asked that question, what is the will of God? If you've ever asked that question, here's my suggestion to you. Find verses like that, and then make sure you're doing the things that that verse says you should be doing. That's a great place to start. If you've ever asked that question, start there. And what does it say to do? It says, give thanks in all circumstances. And I'm glad that that verse does not say give thanks for all circumstances necessarily, right? We're not delighting in our pain. I can delight in the purpose that my pain will have, but I don't actually delight in the pain. That's weird, right? That's not what we're saying. We're saying we can give thanks in all circumstances because of our shepherd. We can give thanks in all circumstances because of our King. And thankfulness and praise are closely related concepts in Scripture. That's a call to praise him even if you're in the deepest, darkest valley you've ever walked through, and it's a call to praise him if you're on the highest mountaintop you've ever been on. So, if this is an area where you aren't actively engaging in worship, meaning that you're not actively pushing yourself to respond, to have that volition, to choose to praise God, well then let me present to you four reasons why you should praise God today. Four reasons to praise God. I will choose to praise. Let's start in verse 5. It says this, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. So I will choose to praise, point one, because God has welcomed me. Because God has welcomed me. You remember last week we talked about the immensity and the imminence of God. Well, that same God has welcomed you. And though you and I severed our relationship with him by sinning and breaking his commandments, Jesus came to earth to solve that problem we had. And he dies on the cross to pay the price for our sins so that those who believe can be welcomed into his dining hall of blessing. This is what he's done. He has welcomed us. And that's a reason to praise. So let's study. How did God welcome us? It's right there in verse 5. Let's just take it one line at a time. First, it says, you prepare a table before me. The picture here is that God is preparing a meal, a dining table for his guest. He is our King, he is our host, and we are the guests. How did God welcome us? Well, first, he prepares a feast for you. God prepares a feast for you. He not only provides what you need, but as we will see through the context of the rest of this passage, this is not a bare minimum, like astronaut food, applesauce with a side of, you know, tube of mashed potatoes with gravy. It's not that kind of thing. Because in the Hebrew culture, this is a high hospitality culture, and they always reserve the best for their guests. And here, the host is the King of Kings. So I think it's a pretty amazing spread. He welcomes you by preparing a feast for you, and then it says, in the presence of my enemies. God prepares this meal in front of those who are attacking you. There's people out to get you, all right? They want to cause you harm. Those are your enemies, and God prepares this feast in their presence. I think what's being expressed here is that it's not the meal that gives you the strength to head out into battle. It's not the meal that receives you from battle so that you can recover and restore your strength. It's a meal prepared for you in battle, in the presence of your enemies. They're right there, and that's where he welcomes you into his dining hall. Third line says, you anoint my head with oil. That alone is an expression to welcome someone. This is why the point is that God has welcomed us. In these times, it was customary that the host would welcome a guest as they walked into their house by anointing them with an oil on their head that was a sweet, you know, a sweet aroma, a sweet perfume. And I'm really glad we don't do this anymore. Because I'm just saying, I don't know, whatever you think smells good might not be what I think smells good. Let's just keep that separate, okay? But in this time, that would be the way the host would welcome his guests. He would anoint their head with oil, and that is a beautiful picture of God's grace. See, you and I, we we couldn't have ever bought that perfume. We could have saved up our whole lives and never had enough money to buy that perfume that our host is now anointing us with. And we're not given it because we're awesome or because of our great accolades. No, it's because he's gracious. He's giving something to you that you don't deserve, that I don't deserve. And I want you to see to what extent God has gone to welcome you. You don't need to praise him to be welcomed. You need to realize that you've been welcomed by him, and that should lead you to praise. That's a reason to praise. Some of you today may be struggling because you kind of feel like you barely made it into the family of God. But you're not in his family because of something you've done. Let me tell you, no matter what you are or who you are or what you've done, it still took the work of Jesus dying on the cross to welcome you. So just be released. Be released of the shame that you have of your past. Be released of that condemnation you feel. Jesus died so that you wouldn't have that condemnation. He dies on the cross to welcome you into this dining hall of blessing, and he's gonna pour blessing and honor in your life. And that's a reason to praise. I will choose to praise because God has welcomed me. Then this, I will choose to praise because my cup overflows. Because my cup overflows. That's the last three words in verse 5. My cup overflows. Let's study that phrase just a little bit. I want to make sure we understand how awesome that phrase is, that my cup overflows. You know, the book of Psalms, these are songs. That's what these are. So it's a collection of songs that the people of Israel would sing, and there's beautiful poetry inside each one of them. There's different kinds of songs that they have, and you can study that. But in addition to the poetry inside the song, there's also beauty in the way that they've been arranged. You can study that there's groupings in the way the book of Psalms is formed. And the group of psalms that Psalm 23 is a part of is built concentrically, meaning symmetrically. Another way to say it is kind of like this. Let me show you something pretty cool. So basically what that means is the way we created a path up the hill is the exact same path that we created to go down the hill. That's how these are formed. So notice Psalm 15 starts with an entrance liturgy, and below each type of psalm, I put like what that leads to, what kind of life that's going to lead to. So an entrance liturgy leads you to a life in God's presence, and then you see a psalm of trust, a psalm of lament, a psalm, a royal psalm, and then a didactic poem, and you see we've created a pattern, and that pattern is the same pattern we follow on the way down the hill with the rest of the psalms, and there you see Psalm 23 as a psalm of trust, which leads to a life of confidence, and then ending back again with an entrance liturgy in Psalm 24. So I show you this to make two points, but the first point's kind of extra credit. I just want to point out something here real quick. Notice that there's two psalms, 17 and 22, that are psalms of lament. And this is where you have a life of honesty before God, where you can just tell God exactly what you're experiencing and how that feels. God welcomes your lament. And you need to know that lament has a place in worship. There is room for you to be just brutally honest with the Lord in worship. I've experienced that. I hope you have too. Sometimes we're just singing a song and it can have nothing to do with the lyrics that we're singing. And I know that my heart longs to lament in the presence of God. And so I'll just start praying that right then. I'll just stop singing. I'll just say, God, here's what's on my heart. Here's what's weighing on me. And here's exactly how that feels to me. God welcomes your honesty. You don't have to put on a face to worship God, okay? You don't have to put on some sort of personality that you think a worshiper is. Just be you and tell God exactly how you feel. Lament has a place in worship, but also notice, lament isn't the only thing in worship. Lament is surrounded by declarations of trust in God and declarations of the victory that you have in God. So you can give lament its place. Just make sure it's not the only thing that's in worship. You can be lamenting at the same time in the same worship experience. You can be expressing that confidence and that victory that you have in the Lord. So you don't have to put on a face, but you can put on faith. Don't put on a face in worship. Be yourself, but put on faith. Don't just sit there only in telling God what you feel. Move on to expressing and declaring your trust in him, even if you don't get it, even if you don't understand it, and knowing that you have victory because Jesus Christ has welcomed you. So let lament have its place in worship. That was extra credit. Now on to the thing I really want to say. So I show you this because I want you to see the similarities between Psalm 23 and Psalm 16. And you know those are the only two psalms that talk about this cup. They're the only two psalms that talk about this cup. And a cup in Scripture, it could be the cup of wrath, of God's wrath, like we see in Isaiah chapter 51. Or it could be the cup of blessing that Psalm 116 talks about, the cup of salvation or the cup of deliverance. It's all that positive, that good cup, that cup of victory. And in Psalm 23, we talk about the fact that my cup overflows. And so let's see what Psalm 16 has to say to help us understand a little bit more of what that means. Psalm 16:5 says this: "The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot." The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. The Lord is my cup. Do you see it? The Lord is my cup overflows. This is beautiful. The Lord is my cup overflows. The cup of blessing that is in my life is not just something God sends my way, it's something that God is. God is my cup. He's not just going to give me the strength I need. God will be the strength I need. And that's why I can say in Psalm 23, my cup overflows. It's not just full. You need to understand. It's not just, oh, we got to a place where things are good. No, it's way, way beyond that. That's why I'm saying my cup overflows. It overflows with blessing. And so I wonder, today, are you worshiping as if your cup is full? Or are you worshiping as if your cup overflows? Because those aren't the same thing. Worship should not be something you're just barely trying to pass the threshold of what would count as worship. A house of worship is a land of abundance. This is not a place of scarcity. We shouldn't be trying to just barely muster up enough joy to respond to God. No, the Lord is my cup and my cup overflows. You just start thinking about what has the Lord done in your life, and that's a reason to praise. Because God has welcomed you and because your cup overflows. Two more reasons in verse 6. Verse 6 says this: "Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever." He adds the word surely just to bring emphasis, like this is important, what I'm about to say. God's goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. I will choose to praise, point 3, because God's goodness is pursuing me. Because God's goodness is pursuing me. See, it's God's goodness and mercy are what we have here in the ESV translation, but that word mercy, I think, could be translated a little bit better. I kind of like the King James word that's used. It's the word loving kindness. God's goodness and his loving kindness. The Hebrew word is the word hesed. And hesed describes a closeness, a loyalty between the two parties. It's indicative of a loving relationship between a king and his people. See, before God became your cup of salvation, he loved you. He already loved you. And you don't worship to receive God's goodness or his love. It's because you have received his goodness that you should want to worship. You would want to respond to that hesed. It wasn't as if he looked down on us and said, "I'm going to make those people family." And then once he made us family, then he loved us. No. Do you realize he loved us and that's why he made us family? That's hesed. That's that relational love that he has for his people. And hesed is translated mercy in the ESV because it's describing the kind of love that God has for his people who are in desperate need of him. That's why it's called mercy in the ESV, because it's expressing that need, that we are in desperate need of God's love, and that includes his merciful love, that he would be merciful towards us, a love that shows his compassionate heart towards you and me. It's his loving kindness. And his goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. His goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. Follow me, that means pursue you. That it will pursue me. It will be chasing after you. Do you see the correlation? Who else is chasing after us? He prepared a table in the presence of our enemies. Our enemies chase after us to do us harm, and they want to hurt us, but they're not the only ones chasing us. God's goodness and God's mercy is pursuing us the same, and it will pursue us all the days of our lives. And it's going to pursue you all the days of your life. Do you understand? God has blessed us. Like, God really has blessed us. Let me talk about just how God has blessed us. Like, here, Harvest Bible Chapel, hear me. God has blessed us. We are a blessed people, and that's a reason to praise. Man, let me give you some reasons why I think we're blessed. If I were to leave the stage right now and run to the back of the room, I could go into that booth and I could show you around. I'd be like, check out this camera, check out this soundboard, check out this lighting console, all these things. And you'd be like, wow, this is amazing. Like, how do we buy all these things? Well, it comes from the Lord through his people. That's how we buy this equipment. But you know why that means that we're blessed? Because 2020 hit and we had enough equipment to put a service online right away. That's a blessing. We weren't planning on that. No one was planning on that. And yet here we are as a church and we're like, yeah, okay, we have something we can do right away. Why? Because God's blessed us with all that equipment. And so I could run that way and you would see God's goodness follow us. Then I could run back on stage. And let's say I ran off stage down this hallway. You know, there's an elevator, you can go upstairs. And everyone's like, is there a second floor to this building? I didn't even know that. Yes, there is. There's some offices up there. I could run over to the accounting department, come into that area, and I could open a budget from last year, and I would say, look how God has blessed us. What? In 2020, God met all our needs. This is amazing. You need to be reminded of these things, that God has blessed Harvest Bible Chapel. What an amazing story of his provision that we closed 2020, and we're like, yeah, God met the need. God met the need, and that's his goodness running after me over there. Then I could come over here on stage and be back here in this room, and I'm like, well, did I lose God's goodness and mercy? Is it still chasing after me? And I could run on stage, and I could be like, oh, what's this over here? Here's a drum kit. And you know, so many churches, they have to have the drummer like set it up every single weekend, and the volunteers come, and it takes hours, and they set up their microphones on the drum kit and everything that's going on. It's God's goodness to us. It's God's goodness still following us. And now the worship team's up here, and I could run over here to this side, and I see people, and I say, God, look, you've blessed us with electric guitarists and keyboard players. Why do we have these people in our church? Because God's blessed us. God's blessed us. And if I came here to the center of the room where I could see all of you, I'd be reminded how God has blessed us. Harvest Bible Chapel, we are blessed people. Because I know the things we've endured, the long road it's been, but we still have the joy of the Lord. And the joy of the Lord will be our strength. Because the Lord is my cup, and my cup overflows. And his goodness and his mercy are pursuing us. I will choose to praise, final point, because I am in God's presence. Because I'm in God's presence. That verse ends saying, I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The word dwell can be better translated as the word return. You might even have a footnote in your Bible that says that. It could be translated return. I think that's a better understanding of what's being said here, that I may return to the house of the Lord forever. David is expressing his desire to go back to the tabernacle. Why? Because that's where the presence of God was. He wanted to be in God's presence in the tabernacle. Then after the tabernacle, you have the temple. Now fast forward to today, and 1 Corinthians 3:16 says this, "Do you not know that you are God's temple? And that God's Spirit dwells in you. God now dwells in us. And we should want to return to the place over and over where we acknowledge and submit to God's presence." Like that song says, "I'm coming back to the heart of worship, where it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. And so I will choose to praise because God has welcomed me. Because my cup overflows, because God's goodness is pursuing me, and because I am in God's presence." Those are the four reasons I give to you today that you have a reason to praise. You have a reason to lift up your voice. You have a reason to acknowledge Him for who He is and for what He's done. So to close, I ask you, are you choosing to praise in response to your circumstance or in response to your King? Today is an opportunity for you to move past worshiping as if your cup is full and enter into the place of abundance where you worship because your cup overflows. Where is the celebration? Where is it? Where's that response that I see in Scripture? Like in Psalm 9, verses 1 and 2, it says, "I will give thanks to the Lord with all my heart. With everything, I will tell of all your wonders. I will rejoice and be jubilant in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High." Notice, I will rejoice and be jubilant. Ask yourself, did I get to the place where I was jubilant in worship today? Did I praise in a way where my cup overflows? That's what I see in the Psalms. Where's that? Or where's that attitude that David had in 2 Samuel chapter 6, verses 21 and 22, where he says, "I was dancing before the Lord, who chose me above your father and all his family. He appointed me as the leader of Israel, the people of the Lord. So I celebrate before the Lord. Yes, I am willing to look even more foolish than this, even to be humiliated in my own eyes." Where's that attitude in worship? I'm willing to look foolish. Even if I could see myself, I'd be like, that's a little foolish. I'd be willing to do that because I celebrate before the Lord. That's why I'm willing to be that way. See, there's a stronghold in the life of the believer. And I know this because I've had this. There's a stronghold, and here it is. The stronghold is thinking too much about what you look like when you worship. And you got to get past that today. I've been praying this week, God, would you break that stronghold? Would we get past thinking, what do I look like? What if I sing? If I sing, what's the person next to me going to think? I brought a friend to church. What are they going to think? I never sing. And now they're going to sing. They might think I'm weird. Hey, that's okay. There's a lot of weird people in the world. We can be some of them. You can sing. Or you say, what if I raise my hand? What are people going to think? Or what if I actually start moving? What if I jumped for joy because I focus on what God's doing in my life? What are people going to think of me? See, that's a stronghold because you're thinking about yourself, and you need to be thinking about God. You need to be thinking about your shepherd. You need to be thinking about your King. He's the one that you're going to celebrate today. My encouragement to you is to stop thinking about what you look like during worship and start thinking about why you are celebrating today. Think about the reasons why you should choose to praise. When we have a celebratory song in church, it's not just so that we have another nice song with up-tempo to balance out the worship set. No, we lead these songs because we have a reason to celebrate. If you have Jesus, you win. You win. You have a reason to praise God because you have Jesus in this place. He's the one we sing to. He's the one we praise. Amen. Come on, everybody, every campus, let's stand up. This is a place of abundance. This is a place where we have seen God's goodness follow us all the days of our lives. So can I praise in the valley of the shadow of death? Can I praise when I'm afraid? Can I praise when my enemies are after me? The answer is yes. Yes, I can. Yes, I can, because God has welcomed me, because my cup overflows, because God's goodness is pursuing me, and because I stand in God's presence today. Let me pray. Father, we celebrate you. We celebrate how awesome you are. Yes, we're walking through some things. Yes, we've faced fear. Yes, we've experienced doubt and frustration, but God, we have a reason to praise. We have a reason to celebrate because of you. You're the one we sing to. You're the one we lift our hands to, God. Every time we shout and celebrate, it's not to bring attention to ourselves, it's to bring attention to you. You are good, and your love endures forever. Father, meet your people here today and help us to worship, because you are our cup. And our cup overflows. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. All right. All right, church. Here's your chance. It's your turn to choose to praise. Let's worship God.
a great glimpse of a never-changing God.
I want to hear you sing at the top of your voice this morning. Come on.
Cause all we want and all we need is found in you, Jesus. Every victory is found in you, go!
That's right, Kim. Come on.
Our hearts now to yours. Every fear bowed down to your love. That we would see like never before.
Come on, Eddie.
Give us a grace.
Of what heaven's gonna look like, right? Man, what an appropriate ending to this awesome series. You know, 2 weeks ago, Pastor Eddie taught us that we will walk through the valley. Remember, he said, not running, but walking through the valley. And then last week, I will fear no evil. And today, we will choose to praise the Lord. Come on, no matter what valley, the perfect love casts out all fear. And it is that perfect love that we should praise, rejoice, the mercy of God. It's an awesome feeling, right? That's what you guys are witnessing right now. You are witnessing children being delivered and set free by the grace of God. And that's worth celebrating. Come on. I hope that this flows into next week, all right?
Yeah.
So when we praise next week, every hand should be raised. You might even see people kneeling in remembrance of what the Lord has brought them through. We praise Him because He's worthy of all of the praise and all of the honor. So as we go into next week, man, be expecting to continue this energy. We're going to open up the book of Ruth. Dr. Michael Rodelnik is going to lead us out in that. We're so expectant to see what the Lord is going to do in our hearts through that series. But here, let's give Pastor Eddie a round of applause. Just so you know, he hated that I did that. If this is your first time here, we'd like to meet you. I'll be at the coffee cart. It's right through these doors. Remember, I'm buying coffee this morning, okay? So don't pass up that opportunity. And Harvest, know that you are loved.